Okay, I thought as we began today, what I would do is try to give a summary of where we've been so far. So for those of you who've been attending the events, it can remind you of the landscape that we've tried to draw out. If it's your first time, I can try to provide a summary of where we've gone to catch you up a little bit. So we started on Thursday night with Mark Husbands, and there we tried to explore some of the larger cultural dynamics at work. What's the big stage setting that we needed to explore to understand how we're each shaped by culture? And he particularly focused on emerging adults, which includes all of you who are college students today, and what some of these cultural dynamics mean for you and how you think about self-identity and community. He also tried to provide us with a vision of identity and community that could orient us. What is a biblical notion of identity and community? How can our loves be reordered so that we are our true selves and loving others faithfully in community centered in Christ? And he helped us ask the question, how do we live well within history, within this cultural moment? How do we do that together in faith in Christ? On Friday, Ken Myers focused more directly on technology and the metaphors that technology provides and how those metaphors shape human identity, along with the importance of being able to and equipped to engage in some critique of technology. You can enjoy it, you can enjoy its benefits, but it's also important to be able to have a critical sensibility about how these technologies are shaping us and how to use them well. He tried to provide a vision of how to live as full humans so that we could be present to one another, and encouraged us to slow down a little bit to realize the full extent of our calling as humans. He also tried to provide a vision of how the church could help shape our practices and our habits so that we can live a little bit differently than the dominant cultural vision and how we can live faithfully in this current moment. This morning, we'll continue with a focus on technology with Felicia Wu Song's talk. She spoke a bit yesterday on the importance of stopping to remember that we are each shaped in the image of God, and everyone we interact with is likewise shaped in the image of God, and we are eager to learn more from her this morning. As I've been mulling over the topics, the themes of this year's Veritas Forum, I've realized again the importance of community and the church for helping us to live as our true and best selves and helping us to find true community. Community is a buzzword. I remember in class last spring, students saying, everyone's talking about community, but what is it? Are we really experiencing it? What does it mean to be together in community? It so rarely seems fully realized. And that was in the backdrop as we created this year's Veritas Forum, along with the question of whether the technologies that connect us so frequently are connecting us well. So we have a lot of interaction with others through our current technologies. But are those helping us create true communities? Those are some of the questions that we've wanted to ponder. And as I've thought about these questions the last couple days, I've become more aware of the ways each one of our speakers has helped me to live in true community. I think I'm probably alone in being here this morning as one who's gone to church with each of our three keynote speakers. And each one has shared his or her life of faith, his or her wisdom, and keen intellect to help me live more fully as a true self in true community. We tend to think of college as the most formative days of our lives, and they are very formative. But I found the years just after I graduated to be equally formative. I think perhaps because you're living on your own for the first time, you're paying a little more attention to how other people are living. What decisions are they making? How are they grappling with their callings? How are they engaging in the life of the church? So it was a true privilege to know Felicia and her husband Ed during those formative years, just after I graduated from college. They were graduate students at the University of Virginia and affiliated with the Institute for Advanced Studies and Culture, and I was working there. I saw them and I learned from them as they wrestled with the nature of culture and how to think well about what is really going on in our culture, about the nature of the academic calling, what that means, what that entails for our lives. As Christians, I saw them intentionally try to integrate their faith into their studies. What does their faith help them to see about how culture should be shaping us, how we should be living, what it means to be a true human, and how does that differ from how culture is shaping us? How do we be integrated people as we live in this world and think about and experience its realities. As new attendees at the Episcopal Church, I saw them wrestle with the nature of church life, with the traditions of the church, with what it means to be in the community of the church. As friends, I enjoyed meals with them, I probed scripture with them, and I saw them embrace people and embrace the gifts of this life. It is a real privilege, then, to be with Felicia a few years later, a little further down the journey, and I have tremendous respect for the ways she has continued to grapple with these questions of culture and faith and technology. She is now the assistant professor in the Manship School of Mass Communication at Louisiana State University. Her PhD is from the University of Virginia, her MA is from Northwestern University, and her BA is from Yale University. She has a book out called Virtual Communities, Bowling Alone, Online Together, trying to look at whether online communities are providing a sense of community in civil society when people aren't meeting as much together one-on-one in things like bowling leagues as they used to. She's won 2 teaching awards. She's given talks at numerous conferences, teaches some really interesting classes. And last but not least, she may not have interviewed as many people as Ken Myers, but she is currently interviewing mommy bloggers for her current research project on the rise and impact of mommy bloggers. It's a privilege to welcome Felicia Song to speak with us this morning.
Thank you so much for having me with you today. It's an honor, truly an honor, to be invited to join you for this occasion. I confess it is quite daunting to be the last speaker, following the likes of Dr. Husbands and Ken Myers, but I hope that what I have to share with you today will perhaps dovetail and build on what they've presented already. I feel like after, if you were there for Ken's talk yesterday, I get 10 seconds to just be quiet and let you guys feel uncomfortable and go crazy, so I'm just going to take a sip. This past summer, my husband and I converted. We took the leap of faith. We both were going to be doing a lot of traveling. We knew it was going to be a rather difficult time for our family. We didn't know where else to turn. We decided it was time. We both invited the Jesus phone into our lives. Yes, I discarded my old clamshell cell phone, and that only did one thing. It made phone calls. And I took on the iPhone 4 with its GPS, its FaceTime, the camera, the email access, the texting capacity, digital recording into my life. True believers of Apple called it the Jesus phone because it was the long-awaited savior that could do all things except survive a walk on water. But having had the iPhone in my life for about 6 months now, I can say there's a strange way in which calling it the Jesus phone is apt. For insofar as Jesus transforms us when we open ourselves up to his presence, so too, arguably, our iPhones and our plethora of digital technologies, they do the same. If we open ourselves up to the logic and the capacities of our technologies, I'd like to suggest today that we will be transformed. Our relationships will change. Our work habits will change. As Ken mentioned yesterday, our experiences of time and space will change. Arguably, the arrangement of our interior furniture, whether it be our brains or our hearts, those too will change. And for some, that transformation might be minor. For others, it might be life-changing. Either way, I want to argue today that there will be some kind of change. And as the internet progressively becomes an embedded technology that mediates the everyday practices of business, government, schools, churches, private homes. I think the need to better understand how these technologies are subtly shifting the boundaries of our imagination and reframing our everyday experiences become greater. And as believers who recognize that God created us and called us to engage in flourishing relationships and community, I think it's critical, as Ken was encouraging us yesterday, to acknowledge that there are true trade-offs, right? True trade-offs that exist between what is gained and what is lost in these changes, and to reconsider how we as a church open ourselves up to these technologies and into our lives. So what I want to do this morning is discuss briefly how the internet has changed in the last 10 years, not 15 or 20, that's changed even more, but the internet itself, how it has changed, and explore what those changes have meant for how we experience friendship and community. So my talk is titled Web 2.0 and the Ironies of Being Connected. So I'm focusing on a particular stage of the internet and our interactions with the internet that I think college y'all who are college students are immersed in right now. Okay, so we all know that today's internet is different from the digital possibilities that existed 5-10 years ago. Right, yesterday's internet mainly involved email, which was a point-to-point communication, reading information from some static websites that a webmaster kind of kept up, or maybe reading, posting comments in discussion forums, listservs, chat rooms where anonymous strangers could interact. And while people still obviously email, they still read websites, right, that are kept up by news outlets or media outlets. People still post on forums. I want us to think about the ways that the internet of today, what people are calling Web 2.0, is dominated by some very important differences. Okay, the first centerpiece that I want to focus on is the emergence of the prosumer. Okay, the prosumer. The prosumer is the user, right? You, me. We're consumers, right? We take from the internet. We are consumers who also produce content for others to consume. Okay, that's what makes us prosumers, right? We are both consumers of the internet, but we also produce content. The concept of the prosumer gets at the fact that what makes social networking sites like Facebook and MySpace, other Web 2.0 sites so dynamic are that not only do they provide constantly updated information, but the updates are provided by who? Not some webmaster, not some news outlet, not a publisher, not some commercial entity, but you, the user of the website, right? So when you update your Facebook status, when you upload a video on YouTube, when you send out a tweet on Twitter, when you post a comment on a blog, you are producing content that adds value to that site. Every time you do something on one of those sites, the companies that are owning those sites are saying, yes, someone else is going to come and click on that website so that they can read what you put on, okay? So you are adding value to their site. And the reason why people go to those sites is to read the public articulation of people's private experiences, their statuses, their own thoughts, okay? So I think what makes Web 2.0 technologies pop like a 3D movie in comparison to yesterday's internet, right? What kind of gives it social impact is that it offers a kind of interactivity that is qualitatively different, right? It's a real-time streaming capacity of updates, comments, all right? So while Web 2.0 platforms empower regular people like you and me to produce content that if you wanted to, anyone in the world could read, the magic and appeal of Web 2.0 is strengthened through Wi-Fi technologies and energized by mobile smartphones like the iPhone, okay? iPads, right? Technologies that are on the go, carried on the person, okay? Instead of a desktop that is lashed to someone's, you know, office, at home, or at work. So the internet has become something that is no longer a virtual place to go to, right? That's kind of how people thought about it for a while, kind of these vast libraries online of information where you could learn anything, town squares where you can go and talk to people, right, that you hadn't met about or met before, or learn the latest news, right, or chat rooms. Rather, I think it's more accurate for us to think about Web 2.0 technologies as moving the internet to becoming not a place, but a fast-moving river. It's fluid. It's ever-changing. It's dynamic. It's a river that we are often, in some ways, compelled to ford in order to maintain our most intimate and our most pragmatic of relationships. With Web 2.0 platforms, we become people forced to wade through streams of blog posts, friends lists, status updates, wall posts, comments, tweets, while simultaneously, as a prosumer, creating our own streams for others to wade through as well. Okay, so we're all kind of in this river, and the water's flowing past us, right? And we're also shooting water at other people, right? So it's this massive mess that we're in. And if we're honest, we can see that it is a web that, on the one hand, joyfully connects us to long-lost friends in unprecedented ways. It's an infinite source of news, entertainment, encouragement, in many cases. It creates access to information, individuals, organizations we would never have previously encountered. It is all these things, but it is also a web that entangles us, it draws us in, and often won't let go. The web that provides great opportunity and opens up vistas of possibilities, also the same web that bears down on us in a form of soft tyranny, that gnawing feeling that feeds that compulsive need to check one's email, to peek at your Facebook account. Just look at one more YouTube video, right? You know what I'm talking about, right? It's that soft tyranny that's always just kind of on you, right? You're wondering, I wonder what's going on out there, right? Someone said something? Has someone changed something? Just want to go take a look, all right? So while many observers have grown sanguine about society's ability to adapt and adopt new technologies, one can't help but wonder what indeed we have adapted to and what indeed we have adopted into our lives. What is happening to us on the most deeply phenomenological level as human beings when our experiences are increasingly mediated by technology? What working notions of friendship and community do we actually already possess that so seamlessly fits with this new virtual landscape? I think in order for us to address these questions, it's important for us to do a little background, okay? Back in the mid-90s, which is dinosaur years, internet age, when the internet first introduced the notion of computer-mediated communication on a large scale, right, the idea of communicating through a computer, right, you think robots, right, the reaction to this idea of forming and carrying on relationships through the glow of the computer screen, which back then was much more like black, like green print on black, right, instead of all the kind of cool graphics we have today, the reaction was quite varied, okay? While some observers have kind of wrung their hands over the detrimental effects that the internet and computer-mediated communication might have on existing relationships and communities, there were many who felt rather optimistic, confident that the internet could improve and strengthen relationships and communities. On the surface, if you look around, it seems that the latter were correct. That is, in the last 20 years, we have continued to adopt the internet into our lives. The internet has catapulted from being some marginal pastime of antisocial hackers to a taken-for-granted piece of our contemporary communication and information landscape. We have not become, as so many feared, a society of isolated individuals staring at our computers, whose online preoccupations somehow draw all the lifeblood out of our real-world relationships, right? We still have coffee with people, we still interact, we actually still do talk to people instead of jacking ourselves in, right? To, you know, some technology. So instead, I think many have pointed to how we have, as with prior technologies, found ways to weave the internet into our existing practices of our everyday lives, right? Rather than abandoning prior social practices oriented around phone calls, face-to-face visits. And many would say, when you look around, the majority of Americans have done pretty well. Like, we haven't completely freaked out. We are engaged and we have the capacity as human beings to engage in what's called media multiplicity, right? Using several different ways of communication to stay in touch, connect, and live our lives, okay? So the good news is plentiful. We've all heard the testimonies of the ways that Facebook or MySpace have reestablished or reinvigorated long-distance relationships between family members or old high school friends, right? My sister-in-law, she has 3 siblings. They play virtual Scrabble together, right? I mean, they live in all different parts of the world now, right? But Scrabble was something they grew up with. That's what they do. So they play Scrabble, you know, and it gives them joy. I mean, they do other things too. They meet and everything, but it's kind of this fun thing that they do online, okay? Personal blogs, whose early iteration found forms in sites like LiveJournal, if anyone remembers that. LiveJournal have enabled marginalized persons, people who otherwise in society would be stigmatized, silenced in their immediate surroundings for whatever reason. They're given voice. They have the chance to have their voices heard and to connect with others who can validate and share their experiences. My Kristen mentioned my current research on mommy blogs. It's a powerful tool for a lot of stay-at-home moms, right, who are in their homes with their 4 kids, no time to get out, and they might, you know, maybe they have a child who has a disability, right? They write their blogs. They have a chance to connect with people that in their immediate surroundings is extremely difficult because of their life situation. Similarly, we all know that the internet provides an individual with access to an infinite number of groups to join, meet with, oriented around hobbies, religion, causes, your favorite indie band, politics, lifestyles, right? And as I mentioned before, the rise of Wi-Fi and smartphones creates opportunities even for people who are not separated by great differences at distances to let others know how their day is going, what they're thinking about, how they're responding to an event through micro-blogging sites like Twitter. So all of these are clearly wonderful outcomes and evidence of technology potentially enhancing relationships, acting as a platform for another way to communicate in a different way, which are not merely superficial, right? We don't want to trivialize the things that are actually possible and the ways that people's lives actually can be transformed through this usage of technology. But if you take a step back and look at the way that the technology is designed, that is, the way they configure how we interact with each other, right? If you consider not what the technology offers, but how it offers it to us, you find a much more ambivalent picture. And the example I mainly want to talk about today is Facebook, right? Because I think that's probably the most commonly used one that we can all kind of think about in a concrete way. So consider the following assumptions that are built into how you connect with others on Facebook. So first, you start your Facebook account, right? Which I know all of you guys did when you were 9, when you weren't supposed to, right? When you start a Facebook account, the only option is to register as an individual. From the get-go, you are an individual unit, okay? Working through society through Facebook. All right. Then, of course, we start building our friends list. Your options are both limitless, just fascinating, and also non-hierarchical, okay? That is, your friends list can equally include your boyfriend, your cousin, your childhood friend from home, your mother, right? It can also include Hollywood celebrities, political candidates, major corporations like McDonald's, commercial brands like Procter & Gamble's Tide detergent, right? Yes, Tide detergent wants to be your friend. I don't know who wants Tide detergent to be their friend, but it's possible, right? You can be Tide detergent's friend. So in a site where friend becomes a verb, like becomes a noun, we feel little or no dissonance with having rock stars occupy the same space as our close friends on our friends list. Like, it doesn't occur to us that this is very strange. All right? While we all know that Oprah Winfrey isn't really your friend in the same way that your roommate is your friend, we all know that the manner in which Facebook succeeds in democratizing the nature of friendship, I think, is very profound. That is, on the site, we end up engaging this motley crew of friends in all the same way. You read updates, you post on a wall, you like their page with a click, you see who's logged on, you post on, see who's posted on whose page, who's removed who from whose friends list, right? Who joined whose group, okay? It's the same mode of engagement that you have between your friend, your cousin, your mother, Tide detergent, Barack Obama, whatever, right? Whoever your friend is. So friendship in this light is no more than an endeavor that involves the daily management of information. And as such, friendships easily become a form of consumption. On a daily basis, we spend much of our time keeping up, you know what I'm talking about, right? Keeping up with our friends' profiles, updates, much as one would attempt to keep up with that stream of news from MSNBC, keep up with the latest weather report, keep up with the latest sports, you know, scores. Okay, it's that same mode that we are called to engage in. And in turn, we are prosumers, right? So we update our profiles, right? We curate our identities online like a carefully maintained museum exhibit that lots of people are gonna see for the express purpose of being consumed. Because we all wanna have a lot of comments, right? That's what makes it work. You don't wanna just put something just because, right? You want someone to say something back. So in one sense, the technology is incredible because it allows us to keep up with our friends' howabouts and their whereabouts, creating a sense of intimacy, an ambient awareness, some people use that term, an ambient awareness of our friends' lives without ever being with them, right? Kind of just know what's going on. However, the means by which we seek this intimacy is curiously consumption oriented, okay? Activities that historically have been seen as opposing tendencies, consuming on the one hand, right, consumption, versus relating, interacting, sharing on the other. These two opposing tendencies are now combined. They're brought together. They're merged into one single practice. And as I kind of hinted at earlier, just kind of a side note, I think what's even more ironic is that beneath all of our banter, all of our chatter on Facebook, throbs the underbelly of a very powerful advertising and corporate industry that is harvesting every little piece of information we offer up, the groups we join, the likes we click, the updates about ourselves and what we are up to, all those things. None of us reads the terms of service when we click agree, right, when we're signing up. Who wants to scroll through 23 pages of legal jargon, right? But in there it says that whatever you do online really isn't yours anymore, right? It's Mark Zuckerberg's. You could do whatever he wants with it, okay? So these seemingly minor details, right, that you just want to share with your friends, they're sifted, they're collected, they're sifted, they're sorted into vast databases worth millions of dollars that can powerfully predict your next lifestyle choices with surprising accuracy. And be ready to meet us when we're ready to spend the next dollar in our lives. And every day online, we are complicitly, because we've agreed, right? We clicked agree, right? We are complicit in participating in a vast and powerful complex of data mining and marketing, okay? Something we most of us don't think about when we joined Facebook when we were 9 years old. So, that's a side note. What is more surprising than this mode of consumption that frames our relationships is, I think, the realization that most of us, as 21st century people, have had little or no problem taking to the internet and its form of sociality. The extent to which we have so easily transferred our pre-existing relationships and social practices to these social networking sites speaks to how much and how long our intellectual and emotional understanding of what constitutes friendship and community have in fact become defined by what a sociologist by the name of Barry Wellman calls networked individualism. Okay, so what I think is more surprising than the mode of engagement that social networking sites kind of guide us or lead us into is the fact that it's really easy for us, right? For most of us, it really wasn't a problem, right, to devote a part of our relationships to the working and the massaging of social networking sites. And that is in part due to the fact that we have already long accepted this new sort of networked individualism that we live under. So according to Wellman, the local community has long failed to function as a meaningful category for contemporary Americans. While we clearly live as embodied beings, the salience of physical location has diminished in how contemporary Americans think about or function within their social lives. Contemporary Americans understand community in terms of multiple systems of friends, contacts, and acquaintances which span time and place. They're overlapping networks of social ties that have individuals at the core of each network. So in one of his articles, Wellman explains, people must maintain differentiated portfolios, I love that word, differentiated portfolios of ties to obtain a wide variety of resources. In market terms, as if he wasn't already using market terms, they must shop at specialized boutiques for needed resources instead of casually dropping in at a general store, right? So in the old days, with community, we think of it as the general store, right? It's the only one you had, and you went to it to get everything, and you kind of just went to it out of habit, right? It's Tuesday, we go to the general store. It's there. You get everything that's there. If they don't have it, they don't have it, right? You can't go and click online. I'm all for shopping online. I can never find anything in the stores that fit me, right? So I'm all for shopping online, right? But back in the old days, right, you were stuck with what was in the general store. Now we can have our specialized boutiques. Our communities are now these networks of specialized boutiques where we get what we need, what we want, okay? And if they don't have it, we're gonna go over here, right? Contemporary sociability, therefore, radiates out from a center that isn't a location, it's not a cause, it's not some kind of common identity, but it's an individual, okay? And I'd like to assert today that our digital technologies foreground or reflect that reality that already exists, and it intensifies it, okay? It amplifies this reality about our modern lives. So to say that social networking sites reflect and intensify a consumer orientation and networked individualism, so those are the two I'm offering, concepts I'm offering or asking you to think about today. To say that social networking sites do these things is still somewhat abstract, right? It's a lot of nice sociological jargon, right? Us nerdy people like these kind of vague concepts, right, to somehow make sense of the world. What are some of the real life outcomes of these two dispositions, the consumer orientation and the networked individualism? What I want to do for the rest of my time here is just briefly consider two possibilities, two possible outcomes, okay? So to the point on consumer orientation, all right? I think the logic of Web 2.0 technologies can lead to a disordered appetite for social connection online, all right? It can lead to a disordered appetite for social connection online. So consider the results of a study that was done last spring at the University of Maryland. They conducted this study where 200 college students were asked to abstain from any type of media for 24 hours. No TV, no email, no text, no instant messaging, no Facebook for sure, right? None of it for 24 hours. And then afterwards, they were asked to blog about their successes and failures during that 24-hour period. They had these private websites that nobody would see, right? So consider some of these results. The terms that the college students used to describe their feelings of going without media for these 24 hours: jittery, crazy, very anxious, extremely antsy, frantically craving, in withdrawal, miserable. The three things that students complained about most during their media fast was, one, being bored. They couldn't listen to their iPods. No MP3 anything. Two, not knowing what the current events were unfolding in the world. Okay, it's very unnerving. Three, and most interesting to the researchers, and I think salient to us today, the researchers noticed that the students, quote, wrote at length about how they hated losing their personal connections. Going without media meant, in their world, going without their friends and family. Okay, 24 hours. One person wrote, "Texting and IMing my friends gives me a constant feeling of comfort. When I did not have these two luxuries, I felt quite alone and secluded from my life. Although I go to a school with thousands of students, the fact that I was not able to communicate with anyone via technology was almost unbearable." Really kind of poignant, right? Confession here. So somehow, despite being surrounded by thousands of people, right? At least this one student was very honest about how she felt debilitated, completely debilitated, because her dependency on the technologies to actually interact with people was taken away for 24 hours. While some view these findings as signs as the millennials generation's problem, right? Constant need for distraction, profound boredom, I think others might be closer to the truth when they view them as symptoms of a problem that is similar, or it might be helpful for us to liken it to an eating disorder. Right? And this is a consumption kind of theme that I'm driving at. Technology, like food, is, I would argue, an essential part of our daily lives in the 21st century, right? It's extremely difficult to opt out. And certainly as students, I'm sure many of your professors expect you to be online on some capacity to communicate to them, Right? So technology, like food, is, I would argue, an essential part of our daily lives. So while it ought not, like food, not be given up entirely, like we shouldn't just stop eating if we have an eating disorder or we're struggling with our weight in some way, right? Our relationship to it can become disordered. And beneath this disorder, the thing that's driving those appetites, driving the dependence, is often some type of larger underlying issue, right? So in one way, Web 2.0 offers a real-time interactivity, right? That fast-moving river that is very exciting and extremely rewarding. It can be extremely meaningful in times of need, but it also stokes the appetite for attention and exacerbates that natural human desire to be known and to feel loved. It is a longing, a kind of search for significance, right, that ultimately only God can fill, but that we often spend much of our time feebly trying to fill with meager substitutes. Okay, so this desire, I would argue, which is natural, right, becomes disordered, that the technologies can put us into or draw us into a disorder because it is so rewarding, right? There is constant feedback that is possible. Now, this desire for attention and significance is hardly new, right? And the disordered nature of it is hardly new. It's not like we're the first people, right, to have, you know, this desire to be loved and to desire for attention or desire a hunger to be noticed. In the 19th century, Henry David Thoreau made the following observation about the then new development of post offices. He said, "In proportion as our inward life fails, okay, in proportion as our inward life fails, we go more constantly and desperately to the post office. You may depend on it that the poor fellow who walks away with the greatest number of letters, proud of his extensive correspondence, has not heard from himself this long while." What is different is that our technologies today have created the capacity to have social connection on demand, right? That poor fellow that Thoreau's writing about still needed to wait for the letter to come, right? And he still had to get out of his house and go to the post office, right? And open the box or talk to the postmaster. Okay, the internet enables us to experience some type of social stimulation 24/7, whenever we want, wherever we want. So rather than accepting and working within the regular rhythms, and I think God-given rhythms of relationship, the ebbs and flows of closeness and distance, of talking and silence, right? We all know that, we talked about this when we were in college all the time, that, you know, when a guy and a girl got together, boyfriend, girlfriend, you know, some of them were like, joined at the hip, you know, like always together, right? And it was kind of like, oh, come on, guys, get over it, right? But you knew that was like the early, like they were probably just dating like first week, you know, because they were like, oh, right? Gotta be together and everything, like constantly. Hi, you know, talking all the time, texting, right? Well, we didn't have texting back then, of course, right? But always together all the time, right? And most of us, you know, if they were our friends, we tease them, you know. But we all knew that this was kind of abnormal, right? This isn't how people live, right? You're not with your spouse all the time, right? You're not with the person you love the most all the time. Like, it's weird. Like, God didn't create us to be like, you know, I don't know. He would have made us different if that was supposed to be the case, right? So we the technology kind of moves us to a place where we don't have to accept that reality of the closeness and the distance that comes with relationship and friendship. And online, friendship can often only be expressed through some type of exchange. Usually it's some kind of, you actually have to say something. I mean, you could poke people, I know you can do that, right? But I mean, you can't like sit, you can't just like be with someone, you can't just sit with them, show up at their recital to support them, right? It's very difficult to do that online, okay? So you have to kind of stimulate, right? You have to poke, right, someone. So the first possible consequence that I submit to you today is that if we open ourselves completely to the logic of Web 2.0 technologies, is having our natural human longing for connection and significance disordered. All right, second, the networked individualism that's intensified online can result in a growing insensitivity to one's immediate surroundings and inability to be present where one is. And I think Ken was kind of moving into this during the Q&A last night. The modern portrait of the family today is one where parents and children are gathered together, sharing a meal, right? They've each had a hard day. And each family's member's attention is directed not at each other, but rather towards their devices. Laptops, iPads, texting under the table, right? We are all together now, but we're all somewhere else, right? We're at the dinner table. I'm at home, but you're somewhere else, really. I don't know what it's like here at Hope, but on LSU campus, you see it at the bus stop. Everyone's waiting together. It's not as cold as it is here. We're sweating together. But separate, in our own orbits, tapping away on our smartphones, right? We're alone, though we are together. Linda Stone, a tech observer, said, "We're so accessible, we're inaccessible. We are everywhere, except where we actually are physically." So the irony is that while the internet renders space and distance obsolete and gives us the ability to bring those who are far away close to us, the flip side is that it also gives us the ability to be far away from those who are near, right? And it gives us the power to choose, to control that. The internet grants us access to everyone and simultaneously gives us the ability to control other people's access to us, okay? So we have access to everyone, but we get to control who accesses us. Even more perilous is the possibility that in our urgency to feed our appetite for social connection online, we also control God's access to us, shutting out the still small voice that may be gently urging us to engage with the person he has put before us. Our socio-technological practice do not acknowledge the fact that we are embodied persons, which does not mean that we are merely physically present somewhere, but that we are embodied to be actively present in mind and spirit. And the example of Jesus being sent to us to live with us, Emmanuel, to be with us, I think is a wonderful example of real presence. Right, God with us is an example of presence that involves great sacrifice, inconvenience to say the least. We agree that it's highly inconvenient for God to become human, right? And his example of presence involves an abundant hospitality to everyone he encountered, whether he planned it or not. And in the same way, the logic of Christian community is called to involve real presence, active engagement with people we may not be naturally drawn to, people of difference, that person that is sitting right over there at the bus stop. And I think the logic of our technologies, in its priorities of personal choice, convenience, and efficiency, however, does not encourage us or intrinsically help us to get better at flexing these agape muscles, okay? So I wanna make sure you're clear. I'm not saying that the technologies aren't able to help us in certain ways if used intentionally. But if we open ourselves to the natural logic of the technology, right? There's nothing, I think, about the logic of the technology itself that draws us to exercise the kinds of muscles that I think as followers of Christ, we are being called to exercise, that we naturally don't want to do anyway, right? If y'all were at chapel, y'all know I'm not a nice person. I'm a northerner. I don't like talking to people, checkout lines, forget it, right? These are not muscles I want to use. The technology does not help me use them anymore, right? Therefore, my hope and exhortation is that we can work together as individuals, as friends, as families, as a college, to become intentional about our technologies, to have conversations about how we are going to practically be intentional, how we are going to change the way we use our technologies, and be led and animated and grounded in some kind of alternative vision of friendship, community, or personhood. Otherwise, I believe we will most certainly find ourselves drawn in to the logic of consumption and networked individualism. Thank you.